Well, without further ado, our guest tonight is Joe Glenton, former British soldier who joined up to the war effort in 2003. He was sent to Afghanistan but became disillusioned, I guess, with what he saw and began re-evaluating his views on the quote-unquote war on terror. When told to go on a second term to Afghanistan, he refused, and thus ensued a battle between himself and the army, which eventually led to him being imprisoned for, was it for 9 months or it was commuted?
Got nine, got did five, five, yeah. Five,
right. So his book, Soldier Box, Why I Won't Return to the War on Terror, charts his life from very early years right through the army experience and what happened after imprisonment as well, and the changes of his views. Welcome, Joe. Perhaps you can start by telling us what it is that motivated you to join the army in the first place.
Sure, thank you. Yeah, as time's passed, I suppose I reflected on why I ended up in the army more and more, and I've had the opportunity to speak to other veterans, and it seems to be the case to me that it's a mix of two things, and it's the underlying economic factor. Generally, unless you go to Sandhurst and you're an officer, they're normally graduates, but generally if you join the army you are working class, poor, very often from the north of England, for example, or you know, the rougher parts of the country. So there's that, and that's really the concrete stuff that makes people join the military. It's always been the case that poverty was the recruiting sergeant. But on the other side is the ideological stuff, and we think about the military in this country in a very specific way. We talk about British identity, and I think it's hard to unpick it from an imperial identity, and the military has a certain place in that. We have certain views of the army. I think for anyone, when you go into a recruiting office, the guy who's recruiting you will look across the table and go, is this, he'll feel you out, and he'll go, is this an economic guy? Is he trying to get a decent job? Does he not want to work in a factory in whatever town he lives in? Or is he a kind of queen and country kind of guy? And it'll be a combination of those two things. And I probably was somewhere in the middle of that spectrum, mm-hmm. I think.
I was struck when I was reading your book that you sort of talked about the jingoistic language and how up until sort of the Twin Towers you had no sort of knowledge of anything. Perhaps even afterwards, not that much knowledge, but just a trust in the narrative that was being given to you.
Sure, yeah, absolutely.
At what point did that narrative start really getting tested?
I think when I was in Afghanistan, I'd pretty much absorbed it, and obviously they do a very basic training is social engineering. So it's there to kind of take a civilian and make him into a soldier and make him a committed soldier in a cause, and it also in a sense depoliticizes you because you're told this is not what you're doing. It's bizarre to me now, but the idea that what you're doing is not in any way political, you're divorced from that somehow. But probably it was about halfway through the tour when Afghanistan shifted from, we went there in 2006, which was the kind of reinvasion of Afghanistan in the shadow of Iraq, where things had gone so badly for the British in Basra. And we went there, and southern Afghanistan's a fairly rough place, but there wasn't an insurgency. And the more troops we put in, the more violent it became. And that struck me. And it was at that point, that said, I didn't question it that much. At the time, because again, you're trained not to, and you kind of shrug off your doubts and crack on, is the army expression. You get on with it.
The reason I'm asking these questions, because obviously it's there in the book, but I think the thing that struck me the most is the fact that I suppose working in anti-war movements and things like this, you kind of have the idea that, you know, 2 million people marched against the war in Iraq.
Yeah.
And that represented, you know, a huge swathe of the country.
Mm-hmm.
How is it then that there is an appeal, if you like, of the army? So you've mentioned the economic reasons and that,
yeah,
that identity aspect of it. Do you feel that that has kind of become more prevalent, or either of those has become more of the pushing factor? Because 10 years on, actually, the army is now really valorized in a way that I don't remember it ever was when I was growing up.
It's a very, very interesting point. And this is my bugbear. This is hopefully going to be another book project, this soldier hero, the kind of soldier hero brand. There's a whole industry attached to this. I speak with a friend of mine called Ben, another ex-soldier. He joined in 97. I joined in 2004, actually. And when we joined, soldiers were hated, and it was made clear that we were hated. There were separate pubs, for example, for soldiers and civilians. I was in Colchester, he was in Aldershot. That's shifted. Mid-2000s, we have the kind of rise of the... And there are quite publicly available documents about the standing of the military in public life, fronted by Gordon Brown, one of them. And they were very conscious, particularly, I think, because the military families against the war were so powerful. I think the government were very conscious that... the wars are very unpopular, and I think to kind of throw a spanner into that, they try and conflate opposition to the war with opposition to the troops, and you really see the rise of this hero industry, and at the spearhead of this are things like Help for Heroes, which is really, I mean, is a fascinating project in itself, and I don't doubt it does lots of good work to help soldiers, not to say the money isn't available elsewhere, which is one of their arguments. You could quite clearly do that. But that isn't the only thing they do. They're also a profoundly ideological project, and it's about lionising soldiers and mitigating it. They can't take away the anti-war feeling, but they can mitigate it, and they can confuse people, and I think they've been quite successful at that. But this stuff is very recent. And it, historically, I could riff about this for hours. But I mean, historically, it comes in and out. You look in the kind of mid-1800s, at the start of the 1800s, the soldier was, you know, was the scum of the earth. Even Wellington, who's the head of the army, said the common scum of the earth. But then with the expansion of empire, they had to rebrand the soldier, and he was still a drunk and he was still a troublemaker, but they had to rebrand him as plucky, as Tommy Atkins, as someone you could root for. And this comes in and out again. And what we see now is just the current expression of that. And it's this battle of ideas.
So when you were refusing... when you were up there in the media, the spotlight was on you until now. Where do you see yourself in that sort of ideological battle? Because it seems that at the time that you were dissenting, this is at the same time that actually that became highly taboo.
Yeah, it was on the rise for sure then. Help for Heroes existed then, and it was really making inroads. But it probably wasn't when it had peaked, and people hadn't... I think people have figured it out. I think it has... failed. I think it's a project that's it's very powerful, and it does mess things up and make things more difficult for people to put forward the anti-war arguments. But it hasn't won over the crowd, as it were. It hasn't been that effective. People are still against the wars. The polls say people are massively against the wars, even if not for even if it's the kind of right-wing anti-war argument, like our guys shouldn't be out there. But anti-war feeling is still hegemonic.
Whilst you were essentially on remand from people who are also being held in the quote-unquote prison that isn't supposed to be a prison.
Yeah.
I forget the acronym for it.
Or MCTC, the Military Correctional Training Center. They call it that, but it's a prison.
Okay, so do you feel now that there's if you like, a swirl of that feeling within the ranks, or do you think that's actually not, that's still a battle to be had? Because... I guess what I'm trying to get at is we had kind of that big anti-war movement that started affecting former veterans and so on, so
in the
States. Are we anywhere near that
now? I think it's ongoing. It's much bigger in the States. In this country, we have Veterans for Peace, which is this crowd, which is very new. It's a British chapter of an American organisation. So you do have veterans who are active. There are it's different in the States because you can be active duty. You can still be serving and be to some degree political, and ex-soldiers and people can go onto bases where you can't do that here. And the army's quite different here. The army has a kind of tribal regional structure, so it's very hard to break that down. But it's still a fight to be had, and we try and do that in Veterans for Peace and another project, Frontlines International, which is just taking off now. We're just setting it up, the aim of which is to get occupiers and occupied on platforms. So we have really good Afghan activists, Iraqi activists, et cetera, and we get them on platforms with veterans. You know, but it's still a... You know, it's all to be played for, and it's an ongoing thing.
And who, if you like, are a sort of a wider audience for that activism? So I think I get a sense, both from your book and even the work that we do, that there's a sort of a huge class divide in the way political approaches to the war go. You know, there's a...
How do you mean?
Whole kind of marginalised set of constituencies, I think, within the working class.
Yeah, really, yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Full stop marginalised, but then also from kind of... being involved or knowing about these issues, even, you know.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, because I mean, I mean, it's very difficult territory because, I mean, you can look at the far right now, which, due to the capitulation of Labour, a lot of people who would naturally be left-ish leaning are now on the right, and they also have this a strange, twisted anti-war argument, actually, again, about our troops shouldn't be there helping those lot and all this stuff. But, you know, that's the terrain as it is, and you have to take it into account. But definitely, I mean, the aim would be long-term to get as near as we can to the American idea of being able to, you know, talking to soldiers, reaching out to soldiers, and having this conversation.
That actually touches upon another point that I wanted to raise, and I'm sort of detracting a bit from your own experiences, so please, you know, make sure you explain some of the things that you went through, because they are quite astounding still to read, even for a cynic like myself. But you mentioned the quite casual racism that you encountered, not just in terms of the way people would speak, but quite deeply entrenched views, and even the treatment, discriminatory, open, blatantly racist, treatment, violent treatment sometimes of other soldiers. How far is that? Is that the issue that actually drives people to war, if you like, or actually stops them from seeing the reasons not to be at war?
I mean, again, that varied from nation to nation. The Americans, I'm not saying all Americans, some of the Americans we served with, and this is a consensus among soldiers who've served closely with Americans, were very, very profoundly racist, openly racist, abusive to locals. The Brits were better generally. Of course, there's racism in the military, but I think it probably reflects the levels of racism in society. You know, it's kind of relative to that. But, you know, of course, you know, say Islamophobia is the kind of ideological lubricant, if you like, of the war on terror, and that does seep in, of course. At other times, because in terms of, like, does the one way to look at it would be, does the EDL kind of have a foothold in the military? I don't think so. There are clearly, I know people who are, or I knew people who I know are now that way inclined. But again, it's still contested, I think.
Do you feel that I'm sort of trying to think of an example that you gave, actually. There was sort of an incident of a superior talking about dealing with the quote unquote N word.
Yeah, for sure.
Within the British ranks.
Yeah, okay. For sure.
Whether that is something that's actually structural across the board, that's the attitude that maybe that was what he was reflecting verbally, and therefore you have an already racist machine kind of perpetuating further racist policy? Or is there some foothold within that structure that you can say, okay, you know what? Nice people, wrong, right intention, wrong.
Yeah, I think some guys, like that guy, for example, was particularly venomously racist, but I think he had, to some extent, brought that with him. Some guys bring this stuff into the military with them. I think that was the case with him. And say the guys I served with who were from London, who lived in fairly diverse communities, were not particularly racist. Other guys from, say, Burnley or Bolton, where there is this kind of tension, were, and were much more casual about using racist terms, etc. But I think that reflects kind of society more broadly. Though, of course, there is, because we've been, you know, fighting in Muslim countries for so long, there is a kind of ambient amount of racism in that sense that's there and ingrained, but I don't think it dominates.
Could you maybe briefly, if you like, unpack, if you like, the things that what the war on terror was about, what actually became to mean to you?
Yeah, I mean, originally, I mean, in a very crude way, you know, it was never a legal thing. I wasn't a conscientious objector in the religious sense. It was just a moral. It was a very, very unsophisticated moral objection. I was aware we were in this country. We were told daily that people were being bombed, that civilians were being displaced, and it didn't tally up to what we were told before we went. We were given all these very precious, pretty titles and kind of banners under which we were going: peace enforcement, development, infrastructure building, helping little girls get to school, and all this stuff. You know, I laugh now as well, but we bought into it. And then the reality on the ground was that we were just causing a lot more problems which weren't there before.
Okay, before I before I bombard you with too many questions, I think I'll see if anybody else wants to join in.
I just want to pick up on two of the points you've made. I don't know if they're claims, that's how I'm hearing them. Mm-hmm. The first is, I think you said that you consider the anti-war movement to be hegemonic.
No, anti-war feeling in this country, even though it's a very broad church. There are some, you know, very, very right-wing people who have this anti-war position, but nonetheless they are still... against occupation in some sense.
I'm just wondering whether there's a kind of misreading, not necessarily by yourself, but maybe by, you know, across the board. And it's not so much that there's an anti-war feeling that's hegemonic, but rather there's just an apathy. I simplify the understanding to the point at which I think this society, this nation, if you like, has very successfully rebranded, given bread and given circuses. Mm-hmm. It worked for the Romans, it works for empire in general. Just keep them fed, keep them entertained. Mm. So in the same way that, you know, the bombs are raining down in certain countries, people are watching the X Factor and eating cheap chicken and chips on the streets. So people are fed, people are entertained. Mm-hmm. So I don't think there's so much an anti-war feeling as just a general apathy. I just, because for me, if anti-war means anything, it means preventing war from happening. Mm-hmm. And I was one of the mugs who marched with Stop the War and these other joke coalitions. And, you know, it should be, they should really rebrand themselves as "We tried to stop the war and failed again. And again, and again, and again." I mean, there are lots of anarchist writers have actually talked about how nonviolence is actually a mechanism of the state to perpetuate itself. It's just a valve. Mm-hmm. I buy into that. I think that's a convincing argument. So I just want to get your feedback on that.
For sure, yeah.
And there was just one other issue as well.
Yeah, go for it.
And that was a point that Arzu brought up in relation to racism. Mm-hmm. I think the problem with that is that when we start talking about racism, we generally start off with an assumed understanding of what racism is. Mm-hmm. And it usually devolves or revolves around a very personal, individualistic model, whereby racism is the exception to the norm. It's a kind of deviant behavior of certain individuals. And I want to argue against that and say, no, racism is an ideology. It's systemic, it's structural, it's pervasive, it's ubiquitous, it could be tacit or it could be overt. Mm-hmm. But it infects everything. The very fact that you have a war machine which allows for invasion is racism manifest full stop. You don't need people coming out and using the N-word or the P-word or the W-O-G word or whatever, these kind of ridiculous classifications. This is the kind of crude manifestation of racism which actually hides the much more insidious systemic form. Mm-hmm. So I just want to get your response on those two points.
I don't think we're probably far off each other in terms of the racism. Good point. I don't think there's apathy. I think there is an anti-war feeling. I think people are maybe apathetic about being able to do anything about it. We're in a kind of political crisis at the moment. There's a consensus across all the mainstream parties, the main kind of roots, political roots. With the wars, I think opposition to them is maybe not resistance to them. It doesn't necessarily equate to the same thing. But I think people are against them. And I think that's anti-war feeling. People are disenfranchised, but they're not apathetic necessarily. I think people do care about them. It's just they don't feel they can... Who can they go to? They're going to go to Labour. Like today, Labour have kind of taken a kind of opportunistic position on Syria and kind of split the commons, but that doesn't make me think, you know, Labour are the people to go to express my politics, my anti-war feeling. And the other lot are more of the same.
Why do we assume we have to go through a kind of conventional apparatus?
Yeah, I get that, but I think most people look at mainstream politics as politics. Yes. I think. Yeah, I mean, I'm outside the that mate. I have no faith in. I mean, electoral politics. There are worse things than electoral politics, but of course, it is monopolised by rich, boring white dudes. Let's be frank. But I don't think people are indifferent or apathetic. I think they just don't know where to go to express that or do something about it in an effective way.
We have another question over here.
To what extent is it? I mean, we were talking about how this whole apathy point. Mm-hmm. But to what extent is it about people not understanding their history and where they come from, like how their identity comes about?
Yeah.
And there's a kind of lack of historical awareness in Britain.
Yeah.
I mean, even when I was at school, I mean, that's a big case in point, but like when I was at school, I learned about Nazi Germany so much.
Mm.
And Hitler, like every year I was told in history the same thing in some other way about Hitler and Nazi Germany. There's no like wider geopolitical understanding of history or anything really. So do you think that's an issue? Do you think people are like kind of lost, and then that feeds into their political understanding of what to do because they have no frame of reference? They have a romanticization of history that is based on what I would call a liberal understanding of history, like that certain things like, I don't know, protest amassing in a particular point and place in time has been effective, when I would argue it's there's not much of a record for saying that's the case.
Mm-hmm.
And lots of things, they're told lots of things that are supposedly really great, or even the party political process, like how parliamentary democracy is great, when actually you've effectively, like you said, you've got a two-party dictatorship since parliamentary democracy came about in Britain. So I don't know, you haven't got much of an option. So I don't know, is there someone needs to grasp, pick up that and kind of say, well, this is the issue. We need to like ask these questions, and people might be more responsive. Like I do youth work at the moment of young people, all different.
Yeah,
they were largely privileged, most of them, but they were all very, very responsive when you started to ask questions about the things that they've been told in school.
Yeah, sure. I think you're absolutely right that people are, when people are kind of denied their history, their collective history, they are kind of cut loose and kind of drift. And I think that's a really big. It's another one I could go on for hours about. And I guess it's the kind of postmodern neoliberal condition where we're all atomized and just floating around. I think to you have to know history. Well, you have to know it to be able to then grapple with it for a start. So I think it's absolutely key, which I guess is what things like this are about. But it's then taking it to the next step. We all, you know, can all sit and talk about it here, but it's, you know, going out and as you know you're having these arguments in your job. It's a grind.
Two more questions here. If you take both the questions, and then if you respond to both. One there, and then afterwards one there.
Thanks, Islamic Human Rights Commission, and Arzu, and yourself, Joe. A few things I wanted to kind of mention to you and get your feedback on. First is the changing nature of war itself, because we're not seeing Iraq-style invasions anymore. With Libya and the Syrian model, there's no troops committed on the ground as there were with Iraq and Afghanistan. So what's your reflection in terms of the changing nature of war, where it's basically gone back to the Yugoslavia, the Serbia 1999 model of bombing from afar and high up in the sky? I was in Libya 3 times during the bombing.
Mm-hmm.
In 2011, we didn't see one plane, but we heard them when they were buzzing above and when they bombed us. Right? So there was no soldiers to shoot at.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to get your reflections on that dynamic. I wanted to also touch upon what Mustafa raised, because I disagree with you and probably agree a bit more with Mustafa, that whereas I think if you give people a 3-box option questionnaire, do you support the war, do you oppose it, you're not sure, probably a majority of people in England would say they oppose it.
Yeah.
Perhaps, right. But that doesn't mean to me that it's an opposition at all. Because opposition kind of assumes some kind of move to oppose. But I actually think there is no opposition. There's acquiescence And people at the end of the day in the West know their bread is buttered by means of their government dominating mineral resources and power across the world. I think that's not even in the subconscious of people, I think that's in the consciousness of people on a mass scale. Third thing was really, I'm asking you a prescriptive strategy, what you think can be employed in developing an anti-war movement. Because my opinion is, an anti-war movement can only be built by the communities in this country that are directly impacted by British foreign policy, that they have to lead the anti-war movement. Because what we got now is a leadership of the anti-war movement which agrees with all the propaganda aims of the British government. They hate Assad, they hate Iran, they hate Gaddafi. You know, anyone who stands up to the West, they hate them. But they just disagree about the way that regime should be changed.
Right. Who's it's, I'll go backwards with those. Who?
Can we take that?
Or stop the war.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Just the whole anti-war leadership problem.
Okay. Hi, Joe. It's Mohammed here.
Hello, mate.
You mentioned about racism in the army, and I just wanted to ask if there is any perhaps new or pre-existing programs that will help, you know, like assess soldier state, whether they're it's new soldiers or as the years pass on, also with regarding to, I think it's PTSD?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
I'll go then. I'll do him and then come back to you. Is there any more?
No.
We have to go. So in terms of post-traumatic stress, as I understand it, in my experience, of trying to be assessed was that they generally the military diagnose it down to adjustment disorder. Why that is, I mean, it could be the case that to admit it would mean they would have to do something about it, and it does need to be addressed. And I'm sure there are lots of people in the military, lots of senior guys who look at the chaps and they're worried about the chaps in that very Tory way, a kind of paternalistic way. But if you're going to campaign for that, it would probably have to be outside. And I do think this is pressing. I understand the average time from event to the kind of expression of post-traumatic stress is 12 to 14 years, and we're, 13 years into Afghanistan. And this, you know, this stuff will often happen quietly, but I can't remember, there's something like 20, this was a figure from a couple of years ago, there's something like 20,000 veterans in the judicial system. A lot of that is related to post-traumatic stress. From various conflicts, the Falklands and before, and a lot of it's drug abuse, self-medicating, drinking, domestic violence. Part of it, I mean, it's not just the trauma of what they've experienced, and this is often kind of skipped out. It's actually the experience that the being socially engineered and being trained to explode. The military trains you to be able to explode like that, and when you come out into the real world, there's no place for that, but you still do it. They don't kind of switch you off. So yeah, I think there's a quiet epidemic coming in terms of post-traumatic stress. And the other part was about racism. Sorry, I didn't quite get it.
Yeah, it's just like the link of the two with regards to knowledge, people's mentality generally, whether it could be swinging towards racism or racism from the start and to try to not let that conflict
be in
a situation.
Yeah, it's a really good question. I don't know if there's a kind of link between, as in, do you mean, is it, would PTSD make you more racist?
Yeah, because you know, if you have already that kind of disposition, mm-hmm. then
Yeah, I don't know if there's a link, mate. It's really good. I'm going to go and Google it. But yeah, I honestly don't know. Maybe there is, mate. I'm sure, you know, when people come back, it's interesting, when guys come back from, if you go on my Amazon page, it's hilarious, you'll find these psychotic guys, not psychotic, I mean, they're really badly damaged, and they come back and they're profoundly racist and angry and damaged. So I suppose if you're damaged, it would make you bitter and you would look to lash out at things. And they are very racist. I'd recommend you all go and look at this. It's 25 stars and 20... against, but the against aren't reviews, they're just like Joe Glenton's a bit of a tool and stuff. But if you look at some of it, it's a fascinating thing to look at, just to see what these guys are saying. It's almost word for word Tommy Robinson kind of tripe, basically. But yeah, I don't know if there's a, you know, that's probably as far as I could go. I hope that gives you something. I'm going to go back with yours. The changing face of war, you're absolutely right. I think they've had their fingers burned. In Iraq and Afghanistan, and we do see a shift. There were boots on the ground in Libya. There were boots, I think so, on the ground in Syria now, but not in the numbers. Obviously, there's people calling in airstrikes. An example of that, I don't know if you remember, the Danny Nightingale case recently. SAS guy got done for having a gun in his house. Mm-hmm. Naughty boy. But the judge at his appeal slipped up and he reeled off. They were trying to big him up, obviously. And they were saying, oh, but he served his country in the usual Iraq, Afghanistan, Bos, Sierra Leone. And then he said, and Libya and Lebanon. And I was like, well, so clearly, there are things going on. But yeah, you do see this shift with Frontlines International. We've got a young woman involved now, Heather, who was working with drones. And she recounts, hopefully she'll write some pieces and we can get in touch through a mutual friend about that experience, that shift away to almost Call of Duty type warfare. Just recap your second question.
Yeah, it was going back to Mustafa, and if I had touched upon it as well, it's about the mass acquiescence, which sometimes we think is opposition, but we're arguing it's not opposition.
Yeah.
It's
I see what you're saying. Acceptance. Yeah, I think we've got a kind of semantic difference there. I think it is opposition, even if it's not. I mean, you could go, opposition is only opposition when people do something, but I still think it's some kind of opposition if people don't agree with it. But yeah, I mean, there is a huge problem with getting people involved. And I think part of that is, you know, it's interesting because I went to uni late. I turned up at 28 and everyone else was 19 and had no opinion. But a lot of those guys were at school when I was joining the army and their first political act was walking out of school at the protest. And that's really disheartening. I think it's wrong to say, I mean, obviously you don't have one protest and win. But I think it's wrong to say that big protest didn't do anything. Bush offered Blair an out twice. He said, you don't have to come to Iraq. And now Blair went anyway, but it has an impact, it has an effect. And I think that protest and that activism did have an effect. And it did, it really rattled. You can look in Blair's memoirs or Alistair Campbell's memoirs now, and there's some evidence to suggest they were pretty rattled up by it. So we didn't win that time, but that tells you a story. You learn from history, as you were saying, you learn from history, so that has an impact, so you try and do it bigger or better or more effectively or combine it with direct action or economic action, strikes, you know. Of course, it's disheartening, but this is a fight, you know. They're not just going to roll over. The last one, I work with Stop the War, and I don't know anyone who's... How do you mean? It was anti...
They don't like the same people the British foreign policy don't like.
Yeah, how do you mean though? Can you unpack that a little bit? I'm a bit lost there, yeah.
On Libya,
yeah.
They called for toppling the dictator, quote unquote.
Who did that though? I've never heard that.
I can show you the video footage.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Footage,
yeah, I just don't know, so yeah. I'd be interested to see, yeah.
They don't like him. They don't like Assad.
Yeah.
He's a tyrant and a mass murderer.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a fan, but you see, I've got this, of either of those people, but I've got this position where I don't have to support one of them to oppose intervention. And that's where I'm coming from.
What I'm saying is they agree with the propaganda war of the British government. There's no difference.
Well, I think they do. Not if they're opposing the war and saying don't invade or don't bomb.
As you know, the soldier, you can't kill someone until you've demonised them and turned them into something worthy of death.
Yeah.
Right? So that's what these guys are up to as well.
Stop the War Coalition.
Yeah.
I've never seen this. I would love to. We're on Facebook now. We're Facebook friends as of today. We're going to be firm friends. But yeah, yeah. But I've never seen that, heard that. I mean, I'm not as involved in Stop the War as I was, because I'm doing more veteran stuff, but I've never heard anything remotely like that.
Well, I think that's part of the reason Stop the War has collapsed.
Yeah, has it collapsed?
Well, it's a bigger conversation.
Yeah. Yeah, we could thrash it out, yeah.
I was asking for prescriptive strategy from you as well.
Prescriptive, can't even speak. That's a big question, and it's a much longer conversation, I think. But we need to build big movements, and again, I'm talking about, you know, if the 2 million doesn't work, this is not easy. We don't just do it like that. But then we have to combine it with other kinds of activism and other kinds of action, whatever they are, and we have to thrash it out. But I'm more squaddy than I am activist. I'm still on a learning curve here. But that's a conversation we need to have, you and me personally, and talk about it, and generally as people who oppose wars and imperialism. But I haven't got a quick fix, mate. I wish I had. I'm sure we all do.
From your peers.
Yeah.
What would you think would work better with them as a strategy?
For Stop the War Coalition.
Just don't worry about the coalition.
conversation, just in terms of what you think would work better, because something is not working, obviously.
Yeah.
So I'm asking you, I think you're better placed than Andrew Murray, for example, to kind of like go to the ground.
Yeah. Well, again, I'm not that. I'm not kind of in, you know, close contact with them. I speak on the occasional platform, but I mean, I do what I can for me and for the guys I work with mostly now. We're kind of specialists in a sense. We're veterans. We've been in these recent wars, and you know, we've got a guy from who was there on D-Day, and guys in the Falklands. So what we can do is what we try to do is very specific. We're well positioned. So when they go, when they start talking about soldiers in a very jingoistic way, we can go, no, actually, that's rubbish. And I'm saying it. And I was a soldier or an airman or a Navy guy. And so, you know, we try and do what we can from that position. I would look to combine that with the bigger stuff because it's only one part. It's the same as the military family stuff. That's really independent. That's really, really important stuff. But that's my, you know, fate has dictated that I have a kind of specialised role. And I can get spread out across all this stuff, and that's what happened when I was getting dragged into all kind of really important stuff, cut stuff, whatever. But you get spread too thin, and so I can speak as a veteran who's experienced it, and that's what we try and do. We're 60 guys, and we're also in this country, and we're also trying to link up increasingly with other countries. So we've had this group we're in now. We've got guys who have contacts with I can't remember the name of the group. It's an Israeli group, Israeli refusers, Shministim. With high school refusers, and recently we had a conference, and it was the first time ever there was American veterans, Canadian veterans, and British veterans, and Afghans, and Iraqis, and a complete other generation, like Vietnam vets, these cool Vietnam vet guys, all thinking about what we can do to counter this stuff. So yeah, that's what I'm at anyway, but it's an ongoing thing, mate. I hope that offers you something, though. Cool, man.
Hi, just a quick question. I'm trying to understand what is your aim, you know, gathering all these veterans. Mm-hmm. And you're saying that maybe you're not really involved with stopping the war either.
Okay.
In the sense like maybe from the military aspect. Mm-hmm. So I'm just trying to understand what is your aim? These veterans are getting together.
Well, it's not just veterans. It's people from the occupied countries as well.
Okay.
I mean, the overarching, this is strategy and tactics. There's a division there. Of course, we're aiming to stop war. And it's people coming into front lines, which is this occupied and occupier thing, come from various different political positions. But our aim is within the context of trying to stop or hinder the prosecution of imperialist wars. We're going to try and kind of add to that from a unique position, which is people who've been occupied and experienced it at the other end, and people who've done the occupying together. That's the tactic and that's the strategy.
Sorry, interrupting. Are you trying to prevent people actually joining the army?
One of the things we try and do, certainly. Yeah. Though, I mean, there are a lot of purely veterans groups, like Veterans for Peace, which is the other group. I mean, my main kind of activist group at the moment. That's one of their central concerns, is to go and oppose recruitment and make people aware. We try when we can to go and speak in schools and just give another side of the story, which isn't, you know, that we don't try and portray it as like a Call of Duty. We say what it's really like as much as we can. Frontlines has a slightly different thing because it's this mix. It's our idea. And for me, it's a very powerful thing to have, say, an Afghan woman and a veteran who served in Afghanistan on a stage talking about their own experiences.
Yeah, but it seems like you're trying to oppose the army, military, and then you have no problem with the governmental structure.
No, we do. Yeah, we do.
You do have that as well.
Yeah. Well, we know. We say
because it's like as a veteran, you're getting the benefit. As a veteran, I'm not talking about finances. I'm talking about you're a veteran, and in the society of a status. You're still getting that benefit and recognition. So is it that you don't want to go against the government because it
might
affect
absolutely.
Your status?
No, I am, absolutely. We are. I mean, the government, obviously the wars, where we go and fight is decided at the political level. So we oppose the policies. In my personal politics, am anti this government and others. But we have a limited remit that within Frontlines International, this is what we do. We get occupiers and occupied together. But it's one thing at a time, isn't it? You know.
Cool. Thanks. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I suppose what was being asked earlier is that with this changing face of war, mm-hmm. and that was discussed, is that now I think you talked about how in Iraq and Afghanistan they got their hands burnt.
Mm-hmm.
And so the death of the veteran is quite an interesting thing because obviously the death of the soldier. Because I would argue that it may have reinforced the war effort because you get strange arguments on the news.
Mm-hmm.
With like people going, well, we've already been there for so long and we've lost so many boys, so we might as well carry on.
Yeah, of course.
You've got
all
this kind of stuff going on all the time. You see it like going on like that. And so the veteran has a strange place in society. Or like the person who dies, the martyr, the British Army martyr. He has a strange place in society. And but now I don't know. I mean, I think they have, even if they're decreasing it, I think they will always keep a residual amount of cannon fodder, to put it quite bluntly, with British Army troops.
Yeah.
So they get killed. I think they don't need it.
Yeah.
On one level, they might not need it. They can just blitz the place, any place they want to blitz with precision weapons or non-precision weapons or whatever they want to do. Mm-hmm. And they can do infrastructure building. They can do whatever they need to do, put pipelines down. But the troops, I think they just keep them because it's just a residual benefit in terms of martyrs. Once they're dead, then they're useful forever.
Yeah. You know? You're absolutely right. Yeah, the political usefulness of the veteran. Like for me, my position is, and most of the veteran guys I know have this, that it's important not to get caught up on the veterans because the veterans are, in some sense, the lesser victim. They haven't been occupied. When you finish your tour, you go home. Nightmare. You all right? We'll carry on. Showbiz. So I go to Afghanistan. At the end of it, I go home. The Afghans don't. They're still there and they're still dealing with it. The kind of way that the soldier is kind of pumped for publicity, they're kind of thrice or, they're kind of abused multiple times. And when they die, everyone stands up in Parliament and goes, hear, whatever the stuff they say. These guys are politically useful, unless, of course, they come back and they're wounded and they need, they're triple amputees or double amputees or whatever, and then they get cut loose and they get their benefits cut. And you're right, they are useful. It's interesting with the transition from Iraq to Afghanistan in 2006, where General Dennett denies it, but is quoted as saying, this is militarism. He's saying, if I don't use these guys that we're pulling out of Iraq, if I don't find somewhere else to use them, then they'll be cut in the next defence review. So, and that's the justification for going into Afghanistan. Now, there's this political economic game because all the services compete for funding. Like the RAF moan because the army have helicopters now, and they're like, that's our job, and so on. And so there is this internal kind of struggle to justify a war machine, if you like that term, just for its own worth, however they value it. Sandhurst, right? No, they're normal. So there will be officers there. The SAS is kind of unique in that the officers are only posted in and out for 2 years. If you're an infantry officer, which is the teeth of the fighty bit of the army, then you'll go there for 2 years and it makes you look good and it goes on your record. But the guys who are permanently in it are non-commissioned. They're just soldiers who you have to be in the army 3 years or 4 years and then you can apply. That stuff like that is being expanded, just like we've adopted drones now. There's various other kinds of special forces-ish. It's becoming like the American army where everyone's the airborne ninja, dudes or whatever. They're expanding this really, this kind of sneaky special forces stuff because it's much more useful in the theatres they're fighting in now, so Libya and Syria, and there's a step away from full-scale invasions, as it were, because as you say, they've been stung.
Yeah, I want to push you a little bit more on the direct action issue.
Yeah.
First of all, I need to know or have some idea of what sort of numbers we're talking about in terms of the kind of organisations you're working with. veterans and these. I mean, are you talking hundreds of soldiers who are?
No,
VFP. Thousands, tens.
Veterans for Peace is very new, it's the only anti-war veterans organisation at the moment. It's been going about 18 months. We've got about 60 guys, something like that, some of whom are very active, some of whom are kind of on the periphery, and we don't kind of hard sell people. It's very important. There's a tendency for the big anti-war groups, like a veteran comes along and they kind of milk them for everything they can, and we're very conscious that these guys are very often damaged. We don't want to do that. So we're not talking big numbers at all. It's much bigger in the US, obviously. Yeah, we're developing chapters in Europe as well. The front lines thing is still very small. There's kind of a nucleus of people. These are works in progress very much. And we, with VFP, we're consolidating at the moment and thinking about what kind of stuff we could do. We're not talking huge numbers at all, but it's early days.
Yeah, I mean, in a way, that kind of answers my second question, which was going to be, if you had a sufficient critical mass, then you could just go for a coup direct.
No.
I mean, we don't need to be having this discussion at the level of discourse.
Yeah, yeah.
Just direct action. Just solve the problem on the ground.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Clearly,
we're not there yet.
No, we're not there. We're not there. But that would kind of contradict the whole Veterans for Peace thing, slightly.
It depends how you... When you're using peace as in P-E-A-C-E or P-I-E-C-E?
No, peace is in not...
Peace
is in... No, no. When we leave, they take them off us. Yeah. Yeah. Unless it's that SAS guy who had one in his house. Naughty boy. Yeah. No, it's new and it's developing. But I can't see us taking over the shop. Not the shop, but the gig anytime soon.
I guess coups are for other countries.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
Okay, I just wanted to touch upon the idea of history that's come up a few times.
Yeah.
Because obviously, just before we started, you mentioned that actually something that totally escaped me, next year is the 100-year anniversary of the start of the First World War.
Yeah.
And that it's actually a push to reinvent the First World War as this kind of great war for liberty, etc.
Like, for sure,
age, you went to school, you were taught that it was an absolute terrible disaster.
Yeah.
Actually really kind of be very supportive of conscientious objectives and so on and so forth. I mean, you mentioned Veterans for Peace is very sort of early in its stages on, but it's part of your work, or are there any other kind of campaigns going where people are actually going to stand up and say, hang on a minute, this is a big rewrite of history and we just cannot go down this road?
Yeah, the problem is there's various groups doing various things. I think it isn't coherent. It should be coherent, and we should ideally all get together and do something, easier said than done, particularly on the left. But we've got stuff planned. We're going to do stuff around it and try and bring our voice into this. And it is being rebranded. There's a lot of money going into it. Cameron's, they're not calling it a celebration, but I think it is a celebration of basically military values, and this shift towards militarism, which you see, it has all kinds of different expressions. Soldiers for Teachers is another one. There's this program that soldiers would be fast-tracked to become teachers as a response to the riots. Now, I know military discipline doesn't even work in the military. I've never seen in my... Since that much kind of drinking, fighting, etc. in the military, and it is celebrated, it's kind of expected. So the idea that, I mean, some soldiers would be good teachers, some bin men would be good teachers as well, but it's the ideological stuff is the idea that we need discipline, and the military has become a kind of cure-all in some sense, which is really unhealthy, I think.
I'll just pick up and we've talked a lot about some of the issues, bigger issues, rather than focusing on your story, which you outline in the book. But when, sort of at that point, when you came back to the UK after having gone AWOL and so got dragged into a correctional system, what was, at that point, your most disheartening experience? What's the one thing that was really...
It was the death of my brother midway through it. Apart from that, I was on a roll, to be honest. Because we had them kind of running scared, but in the middle of all that, my older brother, 28 at the time, I've surpassed him now, died unexpectedly. And so that was a kick in the teeth.
Was there no part of what you saw from the system, or perhaps by that time you were just completely disillusioned by the system, that you know, thought, actually, I couldn't even imagine it would be that bad,
yeah,
despite being sad.
Yeah. No, I... Because I could come back swinging, I'd come back fighting, that was really important for me to... in terms of morale and stuff like that, and because I'd started to fight back and I'd sacked the legal team, they gave me like the worst lawyer on the planet, so I binned him and got my own. And so we were kind of in the ascendant by that point. The real downer was not fear of prison. They were trying to lock me up for decades potentially, so that was scary and it was there. But the experience of fighting back and seeing them dropping charges and panicking when I was speaking out was so empowering that it would have had to be something much, much worse than anything they did, as it turned out, to kind of to slow me down at that point. But in the middle of it was the death. So that was, and we had to, it was difficult for the family because we had to put that to one side to concentrate on the struggle.
Well, obviously you're now free and doing quite significant work in changing people's ideas, and I hope I'm also trying to empower them, as we've picked up on this, that, you know, mm-hmm. whether they're veterans or
whoever,
the people who tick the box oppose but mm-hmm. are disenfranchised, etc., right? Yep. You're trying to turn that into action. I just wondered if you had a young person before you now, this is to wrap up the evening. We have a recruiting office, actually, for the Army, not too far down the
okay.
road here.
Sure, we'll go down after.
If only they were open, maybe they are. if you had a young person in front of you now saying they're about to die, what would you say to them?
I used to take the kind of, first of all, when I was 21 and you told me don't do it, I would have ignored you. That's just a fact. But I used to take this position where you kind of put this kind of liberal position where you kind of put the argument and not really push it. Now I would just very bluntly say, and relate my story, and point them in the direction of other veterans I know, and do whatever I could to dissuade them. And I would say, just ask the questions. Do you really know why you're going, or have you just got it off the BBC? You know.
So we end on the note then. Don't trust the BBC, Joe. Thank you very much.
It's a good note
much.
To end on. You're welcome.
Joe's going to be here. We've only one copy of the book, sadly, due to some delivery issues, which we can talk about once the camera's off. But we can take orders. They will be in a couple of days, and we'll dispatch them to you, and somehow maybe hopefully get you to sign a few. I don't know how, but we'll try.
Yeah.
20% off of everything else in terms of books tonight, so please do support IHRC. As you know us, we're a not-for-profit organisation. Every penny really helps towards all the different campaigns, things like this. The Know Your Rights leaflets, the campaigns for people in prison, the silent advocacy work that goes on, the research that hopefully we hope will, through a generation, if that, change people's ideas and hopefully work towards a better society. So please help us and support us. And also, Joe, if there's any website or anything you want to promote in terms of resources, if you want to say it now, we'll put it out on our website.
Yeah, have a look at and see what you think about Veterans for Peace and get the gist of it. And Frontlines International, which is, I'm going out to Canada in October, and we're gonna really start kind of building that and try and have it as a project in each country where we get people who've experienced occupation at both sides together to discuss this and try and dispel some of the rubbish. And try and get to the nub of the issue and the experience and have that conversation. So do check them out, Veterans for Peace UK and Frontlines International. There are blogs and Facebooks and Twitters, so check them out.
Joe, thank you.
Thank you.